Hello students, so we will continue with the same chapter, that is why do we fall ill. So please open page number 182, means of spread. You know that the communicable diseases or the infectious diseases are caused by microbes, okay? And microbes, they multiply very fast and they carry the disease from the affected organism to the healthy one. See here. How do infectious diseases spread? Many microbial agents can commonly move from an affected person to someone else in a variety of ways. Okay, so because the infectious disease is caused by microorganisms. Okay, so microorganisms, they move and they can carry the disease from the healthy person or the affected person to the healthy person. Now, how the disease is carried? So there are a number of ways by which the disease can be spread. So such disease causing microbes can spread through air, you know this thing. So this occurs through a little droplet thrown out by an infected person who sneezes or cough. You know, like if anyone is having cold and if you sit near that person, what will happen? Even we'll catch cold, because what happened, the how the infection occurs due to droplet. Okay, so what happens if someone is sitting next to you and someone sneezes or coughs? So what happens, that drop particles of that infected particles, it spreads in the air, and anyone who is sitting near the vicinity of that infected person will inhale that air containing the microbes and will also get cold. Okay, so examples of such diseases which spread by air are, please underline, cold, pneumonia and tuberculosis. Okay, understood. So the chances of catching cold or the chances of catching the disease through air is more in a crowded place. Okay, see here. Now diseases can also be spread through water. You know, now like if a water, it generally occurs in those places where the water is not safe for drinker or the where the water is not clean. Okay, now what happens if the excreta of the person, infected person, or excreta of a person suffering from some disease, it gets mixed or goes in the water, and the water is not clean, and someone will use that water, or what happen, will suffer from a disease called as cholera. Okay, this occurs if the excreta of someone suffering from an infectious gut disease such as cholera, so this, if it mixes with water, if it mixes with drinking water, what will happen? A person will have a or will get a that disease. Okay, will get infected by that disease. Understood. Now see here. Okay, now this is another way by transfer, the disease gets transferred by air, by water. It also gets transferred by food, and there is one another way, the by physical contact, like sexual contact, that is the closest physical contact of two persons. So if anyone is suffering from any infectious disease, the other person will also get it. Okay, like AIDS or like sand flints, it's a disease. Okay, and AIDS is also a disease that is transmitted by sexual contact and not by a simple physical contact. Understood? Okay, it's not spread by a casual physical contact like AIDS. Okay, I hope it's clear to everyone. Please underline here. Okay. See, now you know what is the other way of transference of disease. Now you know the, like, there are certain microorganisms, or like there are certain organisms also, you can say, which carry the microbe from the infected person to the healthy person. And such type of organisms are called as vectors. For example, Anopheles mosquito. Anopheles mosquitoes carry, is a vector, and it carries the microbe of malaria. And that protozoa, it carries the protozoa, and when the Anopheles mosquitoes bites a healthy person, and it injects the microbe which it carries into the healthy person, and a healthy person also suffers from malaria. Like female, this mosquito Aedes, it causes dengue. Okay, so Now, organ specific and tissue specific manifestations. Now, you know that the disease causing microbes enter the body through different parts. Some can enter through nose, some can enter through mouth. So, it enters through different parts. But where does all these microbes collect? Do they collect at the same place? No. So, where do they collect? It depends on the part from where the microbe enters. Let's see here. Different species of microbes seem to have evolved to home on different parts of the body. In part, this selection is connected to the point of entry. If they enter through nose, okay, then they will likely go into the lung, because if they enter through nose, then they will follow that path, nose to pharynx, pharynx to trachea, then to bronchi, then ultimately to lung. Okay, so where the microbe collects, it generally depends on the point of entry. For example, if it enters through the nose, they will go and will collect in the lungs. If, for example, this is seen in the bacteria causing tuberculosis. Okay, so tuberculosis, the bacteria, it collects in the lungs and it affects the tissue of the lungs. So that is why it's a lung disease. Okay, if they enter through the mouth, then they do stay in the gut lining, they stay in the alimentary canal. And for example, in case of a disease called typhoid, okay, and they can also go to the liver, okay. And for example, it happens in case of jaundice. So what happened when they enter through the mouth and they can live in the gut, it happens in typhoid, or they can go into the liver, like in jaundice. But it's not always that, it doesn't always depend on the point of entry. For example, see here, but this needn't always be the case. What needn't always be the case? That it doesn't depend always, it doesn't depend on the point of entry. It doesn't depend that the bacteria will stay only in that part related to the point of entry. Okay, now see here, an infection like HIV, okay. What is HIV? HIV, it causes AIDS. Okay, so this is the virus. So an infection like HIV that comes into the body through sexual organs will spread to lymph nodes all over the body. In all our body, there are some nodes called as lymph nodes. Okay, so what happens? They enter through the sexual organs, but they spread all over the body because lymph nodes are found all over the body. Okay, for example, malaria causing microbe entering through the mosquito bite, it enters through the mosquito bite. Okay, first it goes to the liver, and through liver then it spreads to the blood cells. The virus causing Japanese encephalitis or a brain fever, it also enters through mosquito bite, but it goes to the brain, it infects the brain. Okay, now the signs and symptoms, it generally depends on the organ or the tissue which is affected by the the microbe. See here, the signs and symptoms of the disease will thus depend on the tissue or the organ which the microbe targets. If the lung is targeted, then the symptoms will be cough, breathlessness. If the liver is targeted, there will be jaundice. Okay, so the signs and symptoms, see, there are two type of signs and symptoms. One sign of symptom is generally it is there in all the diseases like headache, fever and all, because I'll tell you why. Okay, and another is due to the tissue or the organ which is affected by the microbe. Okay, so here if the lung is targeted, then the symptoms will be cough and breathlessness. So this is due to the lungs which is targeted. These symptoms are due to the lungs. These symptoms developed due to the microbe targeting the lung. If the liver is targeted, then there will be jaundice. Okay, if the brain is targeted, then the person will have a headache, vomiting, fits and unconsciousness. We can imagine what the symptoms and signs of an infection will be if we know what target organ or tissue it's. So that's easy. So the symptoms, I told you there are two types of symptoms. One are the general symptoms which generally almost all the diseases will have, and then there is one another type of symptom which depends on the tissue or the organ which is targeted by the microbe. So if we know that which organ is targeted, then we can also know the symptoms. Please open page number 184. In addition to this tissue specific effects of infectious diseases, there will be some other effects too. I told you, most of these effects depend on the fact that the body's immune system is activated in response to infection, and active immune system recruits many cells to the affected tissue to kill the disease causing microbe. This recruitment process is called inflammation. As a part of this process, there will be local effects such as swelling, pain. Now, students, whenever any foreign body enters in the body, or like if a microbe enters in the body, or a disease causing microbe enters in the body, because disease causing microbe is also a foreign body, so when it enters in the body, certainly what happens, our immune system becomes active, okay, and it develops, or there develops say antibodies, or it sends the antibodies to that part, okay, in response to the foreign body. You see here, immune system is activated in response to the infection, and because of that it antibodies are produced, and these antibodies fights the microbe, try to kill the microbe. But if the microbe is too much, then it's not able to kill the microbe, but the antibodies, immune system gets activated, it produces antibodies which tries to kill a specific microbe. There is a specific antibody for a specific microbe, understood? And due to that, what happens, some general symptoms develop like inflammation, okay, pus, swelling, redness, fever. So this is due to the response of the immune system to the microbe. So this is the general symptoms which is found in almost most of the diseases, okay. Other than that, there are symptoms which is due to the tissue which is targeted by the microbe, okay. Those symptoms develop depends upon the microbe targeting the tissue, other than these general symptoms. In some cases, the tissue specificity of the infection leads to a general screening test. For example, in HIV infection, the virus goes. So in HIV infection, what happens? The virus destroys whole of the immune system. It affects the immune system. The virus goes to the immune system and damages the immune system. So many of the effects of HIV AIDS are because of body can no longer fight of the many minor infection that we face every day. So that's very because the immune system is destroyed. Like if the immune system, what it does when any foreign body enters or a microbe enters, it produces antibodies which automatically kills the microbe, and these are the minor infections which is caused, or minor due to the entry of the microbes. Here the immune system only kills the microbe, so there is nothing to worry. So this happens day to day, but when in case of HIV infection, what happens, the whole of the immune system is damaged. So if even the slightest infection is not cured, suppose the microbe of a cold enters in the body, virus enters in the body, then since the immune system is damaged, it doesn't produce antibodies to kill that microbe causing cold. Okay, so the minor infections are not cured. Every day, students, we suffer from minor infections, but we are not aware because our immune system, it becomes activated and it produces antibodies which automatically kill those microbes. But in case of HIV infection, it does not occur. So in case of HIV infection, sometimes even the minor infection becomes the major cause of worry. Even this minor cold can turn to be pneumonia, okay, and kill a person suffering from AIDS. So AIDS, in AIDS person dies just because of the infection. The body cannot protect, is not protected, okay. So by minor infections, it is also important to remember that the severity of the disease also depends upon the number of microbes in the body. If the microbes in the body is less, then severity of the disease is not much. But if the microbe is more, then the disease is very severe and it can even lead to death of a person. Principles of treatment. What are the steps taken in your family? Okay, based on what we have learned so far, it would appear that there are two ways of treating the infection. One is to reduce the effect of the disease, and another one is to kill the microbe. So first one, in first case, to reduce the effect of the disease, what happens? The symptoms, the effect of the symptoms or the signs which causes uncomfort or discomfort to the body, that is reduced, but that does not kill the microbe. Okay, by taking medicines or by taking treatment, only the symptoms are reduced. Okay. effects of the disease, which is symptoms or signs, are only reduced, but only till the effect of medicine lasts. Afterwards, again the symptoms will develop because the microbe is still in the body. So that is the first, and second one, to kill the microbe. So once the microbe is killed, the permanent this solution is found, like the disease, it goes permanently. But in first case, where the symptoms are reduced, the disease doesn't go permanently. Okay, here this paragraph. Now, how do we kill the microbe? That we have already discussed. How do you kill the microbe? You know that there are microbes. There are five different group of microbes: bacteria, fungi, protozoa, algae, viruses, and all these groups, they are different from one another. Okay, like viruses, they have some common biochemical pathways or biochemical life processes. Bacteria have some, protozoa and some. Okay, now in how it's done, how the disease is, or how the microbe is killed, a drug is taken, that type of a drug is taken which blocks any one pathway. Like in bacteria, as we did before, bacteria synthesizes cell wall also to protect it from the harmful condition. So now, but that is not done by viruses or any other microbes. So now, if the antibiotics are taken, then that antibiotic will block that pathway, and the bacteria will not be able to make the cell walls. Thereby, bacteria will be killed. And once the bacteria, the microbe is killed in the body, person gets relief from the disease. But it doesn't harm the human cell. So only thing what I want to say is this: any one pathway, first whenever anyone gets an infectious disease, first of all the microbe, once we know what is the cause of the disease, what is the microbe which has caused the disease, then the that particular type of a treatment is given which blocks any one of the pathways. Understood? Now, one way of one reason why making an antiviral medicine is harder than making an antibacterial medicine is that viruses have very few biochemical mechanisms of their own. They enter our cells and use our machinery for the life processes. So they don't have their own biochemical biochemical life processes. After entering, they use our mechanisms only. So they enter our cells and use our machinery for the life processes. This means that there were relatively few virus species targets to aim at. But despite of all these limitations, also some of the drugs, antiviral drugs, are manufactured. For example, the drugs that keeps HIV infection under control. So that viral antiviral drug is also now used. Understood? Now, principles of prevention is only left, that we will discuss in next class. Okay, students, thank you. Have a nice day.